Hey there, welcome back to Zombie Tactics today with another episode in the Ammo Can of Worms series. We're going to kind of take a little detour here. We've been talking about the effectiveness of handgun cartridges and calibers for a little bit and some of the myths and misunderstandings having to do with the science of the terminal ballistics on those things. Kind of a little detour, we're going to talk about this platform today, the AR-15, or as it's known in the military, an M4. Now the M4, of course, would be a select fire version of this that would be able to shoot not only semi-automatic, but also burst fire and full automatic. This is a civilian model of that, an AR-15, so it is only a semi-automatic version of it. This, of course, is the Smith & Wesson M&P-15 Sport. It's a kind of a bargain basement, value-priced AR-15 that I've been having a lot of good results with, much better than I've expected. And that's just kind of here as a prop so that we know what we're talking about. I want to talk about today something that's not really so much a myth as it is what I'll call a misunderstanding having to do with the effectiveness of this weapon and the associated cartridge with it, a 5.56 cartridge, or a civilian hunting round version of that, the 223. Now, for all intents and purposes, we're talking about not combat in the military here. We're talking about self-defense, home defense, law enforcement kind of pattern of use. So keep in mind that's the context that we're talking about, and I'll talk about a couple of points about that a little bit having to do with this. The piece of information that I want to deal with here has to do with the rumored ineffectiveness of the AR-15 platform. Now, most of that information does come from a combat environment, and that does have a little bit to do with our discussion, and it goes a little bit like this. It's kind of like, well, this is not an effective man stopper. This weapon is not an effective man stopper because this cartridge is not an effective man stopper. And like I said, that's not really a myth. It's a little bit of a misunderstanding, and I want to try and clear that up. So whether we're using something like this AR-15 chambered for 5.56 millimeter, we're using a Mini 14, a Kel-Tec SU-16 CAA, most modern weapons that are chambered in 5.56 millimeter or .223 caliber will fire either cartridge, a 223 or 5.56. If you have any doubt about that, if your weapon is marked, the barrel's marked on it, 223 for instance, check with the manufacturer and make sure that it's good to go to shoot 5.56, because we're talking about those both interchangeably here, because most of the common weapons will use those cartridges interchangeably without any issues. Okay, so getting down to brass tacks, what we're really talking about here is not so much this weapon, but the cartridges that are used in that, because that's kind of the point of contention. And again, it doesn't matter. If we're shooting these cartridges out of a 16-inch barrel, it doesn't matter whether that's a Mini 14, a Kel-Tec SU-16, or an AR-15, or any rifle that shoots this cartridge out of a suitable 16-inch barrel or something longer. The effects, the terminal effects, are going to be the same, pretty much, within reason. So I'm going to put this on the table here, and since this video is not really about that weapon per se, but the cartridges, and it's certainly not about my face, I'm going to move to a different camera angle so that we can talk about these rounds in greater detail. Okay, so the autofocus tends to be a little bit clunky when you try to get really close on something like this. So for a lot of these cartridges, I'm going to go ahead and show you photographs as we go along here. The two primary cartridges used by the military are these here. This is a 193 ball round, and this is, you can even see it with the bad autofocus, that this is the green tip, or the M855 ball round. Now, these are slightly different in a couple of ways. One of them is the cartridge weight here, the weight of the projectile, the part on the end here that actually comes out of the barrel, is 55 grains, and this one's a little heavier, it's 62 grains. Now, when the AR-15 platform first came out in the military, it was very feared by our opponents, and that was because the barrel twist in that weapon had a twist of about 1 in 12 inches twist, and that caused the bullet to kind of wobble in flight as it flew. Two things about that: it made it somewhat inaccurate, and at the same time it also meant that when that bullet hit something, it would tend to twist, yaw, spin, whatever. That's why you get all of these stories about people in Vietnam talking about how you get hit with an AR-15, you get hit with an M4, and it'll just spin on up your chest cavity or something like that and rip the heck out of you. There was a phrase that the Viet Congs had that translated means beware the black rifle. And they were very afraid of this rifle, although at that time we were kind of having problems with the mechanical operation of the rifle because of the desert conditions. Now, as time went by, they moved to different barrel twists, 1 in 9 inches, and now the current one, which is 1 in 7. And that does a couple of interesting things. One of them is that it stabilizes the barrel in flight better, and that makes it accurate out to greater distances. That was one thing we really wanted out of that. But in the same, at the same time that we've accurized that cartridge by putting more of a spin on it, we've also caused a situation where it's less likely to do that kind of wobbly thing where on impact it'll twist and cause all that great damage. So there is a slight tendency for this round to do something called ice picking. Now, ice picking tends to happen not so much at intermediate distances, say, 25 yards or 50 yards or whatever. It happens at very close distances, and it happens at very far distances. That's kind of the information that I get from the sources that I'm looking at. And ice picking means that it doesn't do a whole lot of damage. It just goes straight through and through, and it doesn't cause any secondary wounding effects because of the pressure wave that follows the bullet or things like that. Now, that does, in fact, happen with this cartridge, the M193, and it happens even more so with the M855. And the reason for that is, again, because they tried to accurize the cartridge. Well, the Soviets knew that, and when they decided, because they wanted to move to a smaller cartridge, they moved to the 5.45, they made their cartridges so that they could virtually guarantee that you would get that twisting, turning, yaw, whatever kind of motion upon impacting human flesh. And the way that they did that is they put a little air pocket behind the tip of the round so that upon impact it would crush the tip of that round, and that because that crush would be inconsistent, it would mean that, boom, it's going to start doing spinning and doing all kinds of stuff like that. That's why the 5.45x39 bullet is referred to as the poison bullet, because it just rips the heck out of people when it hits them. And we didn't do that. Our primary concern was that people were complaining about this round, the M193, not doing very well through intermediate or incidental armor like building walls or car doors and things like that. So even though this was a fairly effective combat round, far more effective than most people want to give it credit for, we've moved primarily and mostly to the M855, the green tip. That's also called the penetrator. And it's called the penetrator because it is designed, both because of the heavier weight and because it has a steel core and some other stuff, to penetrate better through those kinds of incidental barriers. That same behavior makes it much more likely to do that ice pick effect, where it just makes a straight through hole and does no more damage really than a .22 caliber long rifle would in some cases. Now, that tendency, I think, from the information that I've read, is a little bit overblown. It happens often enough that it's a concern, but it doesn't happen all the time. And being that standard military protocol is to shoot them twice anyway, that's maybe not something that we're as worried about or should be as worried about as sometimes people make it out to be. But it is a concern. Now, I said at the beginning of this video that I'm really not so concerned about military use of the AR-15 platform or any similar rifle, so why am I doing all this talk about the military? I want you to know where this idea that the 5.56 is ineffective came from. It came from the fact that sometimes people do exhibit, they do observe this behavior where the round does that ice-picking effect rather than tearing the heck out of somebody, which is what a rifle round is supposed to do on impact. Why doesn't that affect us as citizens, and why should we not worry about it so much? Well, first of all, that effect is probably overreported, meaning it doesn't happen as often as you think, and it doesn't happen so much at the ranges that are typical for law enforcement or self-defense, you know, armed citizen kind of encounters. So even if you're just using the 193, you're in pretty good shape. I wouldn't necessarily go for the M855, because as a citizen, you're not necessarily going to be shooting through car doors. If you're shooting through car doors, you're probably in the wrong situation, and you're probably not shooting something you ought to be shooting. Get the heck out of there or whatever. But the M193 is probably still a pretty effective round for you to use and does a fine, fine job. You can find pictures all over the internet of people with their thighs and their torsos and their heads half blown off from this round. So don't overthink it. If this is what you want to use in your rifle, it's probably going to do a fine job for you. A lot of police departments, though, since they're not bound by the Hague Convention, which says that you can only use, a full metal jacket cartridge, you cannot use hollow points or any other kind of expanding or fragmenting rounds. By the way, the United States is not a signatory to the agreement, but we abide by it for the most part nonetheless. So the military is bound by that, by their own policy more than anything, to use only these full metal jacketed rounds. We don't have to use that as citizens, and certainly police departments don't do that either. What we want to do is we want to ensure as much as we possibly can that when that round hits somebody, that it is going to exhibit that twisting, yawing, spinning behavior. Well, with a pistol bullet, if we make a pistol bullet have a hollow point tip on it, that causes the tip to expand, and we get better effects out of that, out of a pistol bullet, only because it increases the size of the round. It just makes a bigger hole, but it doesn't really cause pistol rounds to do twisting, spinning, and all that kind of crud. However, in the case of a rifle round, we can get quite a bit of that by just causing any deformation of the round at all. Now, keep in mind, I talked about how the Russians, they use their 5.45, which is the analogous cartridge to this one, in the AK-74, and they put a little area at the beginning of the round where it will crush upon impact, and it causes that spinning, twisting behavior. With a full metal, with a hollow point shell in a hollow point projectile in a rifle, you don't get a big effect by causing a bigger wound channel because it expands and you know, you've now got an expanded shell. What happens is because that expansion never happens consistently and rifle rounds are moving much quicker, it does cause enough deformation of the cartridge upon impact that you're now going to get that spinning weird behavior where it's just going to rip the heck out of crap. So police departments and us as citizens, we're not bound by that requirement to use only these full metal jacketed shells. We can go with hollow tip rounds or some other kind of a round that's designed to cause that deformation. Now, we don't have to go for a kind of a high dollar round, and here's an example of a high dollar round. I think these cost over a dollar a piece. These are a round made by Winchester. They're called Razorbacks, and they're designed for pig hunting. And because they're designed for pig hunting, and pig flesh is pretty close to human flesh, it's actually used in testing terminal ballistics, that's an excellent round. But like I said, those are about a dollar a piece. And they've got a really good design that will deform on impact and cause all kinds of damage. We don't necessarily have to do that as citizens, though. We can go ahead and we can get other rounds. Here's a couple of examples that are working well for me. I've got a Wolf soft tip, and that's a soft tip in 55 grain. And the soft tip means that there's a little bit of lead at the front. And that lead, upon hitting, it's going to deform, and it's going to cause that projectile to have an inconsistent behavior, meaning it's going to spin, it's going to twist, it's going to yaw. And the same thing for the Silver Bear 62 grain cartridge. Again, a hollow point, which we're not worried about the fact that it's expanding a whole lot. We're worried about the fact that it does any kind of deformation of the tip of the round when it hits. And that deformation is going to cause that round to have a whole lot more damage, or to create a whole lot more damage. So because we are not limited to the things that the military is limited to when we're using a AR-15 or a similar rifle chambered in .223 or 5.56 for home defense, self-defense, or law enforcement use, all of these questions about the ice-picking behavior of the .223 5.56 round really don't have to apply to us if we just do a little bit of homework and use a soft tip, a ballistic tip, or a soft point round. Now, I showed you the hollow point, and I showed you soft tip rounds. There's also something called a ballistic tip, and that has kind of a little plastic end cap on it. That plastic will deform quickly and cause the same kinds of effects. So if you're going to be loading up an AR-15 for use as a self-defense weapon, don't get worried about all of this talk about how it's an ineffective cartridge. Go ahead and get something that you know will do the job, something that's designed to deform upon impact, and that should settle the whole issue for you. That's Zombie Tactics for today. And we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.